today I'm going to be tinkering with this little circuit here, which is something that I've mentioned in passing a couple of times, but now that I've got all the bits and pieces that I need for it, I can actually get busy and play with it. This is a little headphone amplifier based on a kind of specialish op amp IC. Here's the schematic of it. It's super simple, actually. It's just a fairly straightforward op amp application using this OPA2134 op amp. And as you can see down here, this is called the mini amp. And this implementation was created by a dude named Dustin Watts. So Dustin, on his YouTube channel about a year ago, built this amp up. He etched a circuit board and built it up and whatnot, and corrected it and did up the schematic and everything else. So there's, I'll link to probably the first video in his series of videos about it. And I've actually noticed that recently he started revisiting it and making a new version. So that could be interesting to see what he comes up with afterwards. But he didn't come up with the original one. Originally, it was come up with by this CMoy guy, and it was called the CMoy Pocket Headphone Amplifier. It's even got its very own Wikipedia article. But here's the original article where he published it and came up with it. And there's one channel of it. He's using the OPA-134, which is the single op amp. I'm using the dual op amp, but it's the same guts under the hood, just two of them. We'll look at the schema, data sheet for that in a minute. But if you notice the circuit, this is a very standard non-inverting op amp circuit. So basically your signal comes in through a series resistor, just so you don't load down the input or the output of whatever you're putting it into, and then a capacitor for DC block, and a resistor to create a bit of a voltage divider there, just to give you a reasonable input that goes into the non-inverting input, comes out through the load resistor, and then you have a feedback resistor and actually a voltage divider again up there. But the important one is this R4, which is a feedback resistor, which is what sets the gain of the whole amplifier. You send a portion of the output back to the inverting input, which applies at 180 degrees flipped out of, I don't want to say out of phase because it's not out of phase, but that's the common language of it. And so that basically pushes back against the input, because it's the same signal essentially. There's negligible delay in there, and that just reduces the overall output level. So that is your gain setting resistor in any inverting or non-inverting op amp circuit. And realistically, you could drop just about any op amp into this circuit, but this particular op amp has a very decent frequency range and way beyond audio, nice and flat, way beyond audio. At the low end, it's on a 1020, starts dropping off at about 30 hertz or thereabout, which on headphones, who cares? You're not going to hear below there on a set of headphones anyways. You're not going to have a subwoofer stuck to your side of your head. At least I hope not. So the other thing that happens in this design and in Dustin's slight modification of it is that the power supply, to power it from a battery, these op amps need or should have a dual polarity power supply, plus and minus voltage. So to get that, again, just a little voltage divider, some stability capacitors, and an LED just for LED-ness. Here is said op amp. The CMoy version, or the CMoy version, used a pair of 134s. Dustin's, and the one I've got on my breadboard, uses a 2134, which is the dual op amp, or the dual channel one. And the specs that make this op amp special is this distortion number here. And that's ridiculously low. The frequency, the bandwidth up to 8 megahertz, that's way beyond what you need for audio. Open loop gain, that is if you don't have a feedback resistor and you're just running the thing flat out, it can do 120 dB of gain. So basically your output is 120 dB hotter than your input. Wow. But that is kind of limited by the power supply rails. It will run on plus or minus 2.5 volts. So you could run it off some pack of AA's, basically, four AA's to create your dual power supply, or up to plus or minus 18 volts. With a 9-volt battery in the power supply design that we saw earlier, it's going to be plus or minus 4.5 volts, which for headphones is more than enough. So back to this one that I've got on my breadboard. This is a version that I was tinkering with previously, and you may remember in the last mailbag, I think it was, I got some of these little stereo potentiometers in so that I could actually use it in stereo. Now, for breadboard purposes, this thing didn't quite fit, so I ended up bending the back pins out of the way and soldering some header pins on there to make it breadboard friendly. And now it works quite nicely in a breadboard. So I'm going to switch that in. This is the values that Dustin came up with. They're based off that original CMoy, but I think he tinkered it a little bit. It's been a while since I've watched his entire set of videos, but I'm pretty sure he customized them a little bit. And I'm just going to go with exactly what he's got there. So at a 47 ohm series resistance. Just for the bench, I've got a couple of cheap little speakers. It's going to sound like crap on those speakers, okay? Don't sweat it, because you're listening to speakers through a microphone, and it's not going to sound great in that application. This is just for demonstration, right? It does sound much better in real life and with headphones or good speakers, but I can't demonstrate that to you guys, so here we go. There is pretty much exactly that same power supply, 9-volt battery, 4.7K resistors creating the voltage divider. There's the positive voltage coming out and the negative voltage coming out, and ground halfway between them. Let's just fire it up. So 9-volt battery onto there. We have achieved LED. That's good. That's plugged into there. Source of sound. Powered on. And volume control up. That's already distorting these little speakers. Okay, you've heard my cheesy copyright-free music before. And again, you don't need to hear it through that. Actually, let me pause. Let me get one better speaker anyway, just so that maybe you can hear it a little bit better. I don't know. It's still not going to sound great going through speaker to microphone, but we'll try this. Okay, that sounds a little bit cleaner. And you've probably heard this music on some other videos of mine, so that's actually pretty decent on this. And it can get fairly loud too, but again, coming out of a battery, 4.5 volts peak to peak, oh, 9-ish volts peak to peak is about the best you're going to get, because that's where the rails are, right? With an op amp, basically the voltage, or the best voltage output that it can get, is to the power supply rails. Obviously, then it's going to clip, or within a few millivolts of the power supply rails, depending on how efficient the thing is. I wonder if I can show you on the scope. Hang on. Okay, well, this isn't exactly what I wanted to show you, but for now, that this is the input trace, that's the output trace. The input trace is set to 50 millivolt scale. Let me set the output trace to the same scale. Yeah. Anyway, let's turn that down to the 0.5-volt scale. So that's on the 50 millivolt scale, and that's on the 500 millivolt scale. So that's pretty cool. That's not going to show the distortion though. I'm going to need a clean sine wave to do that. And so here is a clean sine wave. And again, if I increase the output here, let me just change scales again so you can see it. There, right there. You see I'm starting to run into the positive power supply rail, and down at the bottom you see it's starting to hit the negative power supply rail. So it's never going to go any higher than that. And so that's 2 volts peak to peak. That's a lot further from the power rails that I was expecting. But regardless, that's the clipping there. And I could get that to clip a lot higher. I'm going to leave all my settings the same. And I'm going to change the power supply. So instead of using, hang on, instead of using this to split the battery in half, a 9-volt battery in half, I'm going to use 2 9-volt batteries. So I know this is going to look a little bit weird because I've got a negative and a positive connected together. But that is actually the ground of the circuit, which is halfway between the positive voltage rail, this one, and the negative voltage rail, this one. The positive voltage rail, I just double checked, and the positive voltage rail goes to the pin 8, and the negative goes to pin 4, and the ground doesn't connect to the chip. It's halfway between, and it's just out there. So I connect these two up. I should have a much higher voltage. Now, I didn't change the volume setting on the board. I didn't change the volume setting on my tone source. I didn't change the scope settings. But you see where the there's where we had our voltage limits before, right? So we have already exceeded it. I'm going to change scales on the output, and I'm going to crank up the volume again. And that's actually hit the maximum that I can do on the pot. So I'm going to turn up the level on my signal generator. And there we're starting to clip. There. Oh, let's drive it right into clipping. And where's my cursors again? Wait a minute. I have to turn off channel 1 because it's there. That's what the problem was before, too. So, I'm going to just mute that a little bit. When I had channel 1 turned on with the showing the input, it was using its scaling. So now we've got like 10.5 volts before we hit clipping. I'm just going to back that down a little bit so it's not clipping anymore. But yeah, so that's a pretty solid little amp that can do that sort of gain. Now, I want to play with the frequency response of this a little bit just to test the gain. So I'm going to change the setup slightly here, and I'll be right back. Okay, so now I've got the two traces set so that they look like the same level. They're not trace 2. This one is actually set to the 2-volt scale, and this one is still set to the 1/2-volt scale. That's the input. But if I position them, I can put them right over top of each other. So if there's any non-linearity or anything, we should be able to see it pretty easily. So I'm going to change my my frequency source to 100 hertz. And let's bring in the time base a little bit. See, they're still the same. It's hard to see at that slow, but they're the same. And it gets really hard to see when you go to lower. But regardless, let's go to higher. Change up the time base again so we can see it. So there's 5 kilohertz. Again, the input and the output are indistinguishable. Can you hear that little speaker? I hope it's not bothering you. You won't be able to hear it now. This is 10 kilohertz. And it's more than that speaker can handle. But, again, you see the little amp. Input and output is just fine. There's no distortion between the input and the output signal at all that I can see anyways. Let's try 15 kilohertz. And I'm going to spread that out a little bit more so we can see it better. And drop that down. And again, no obvious distortion. Pretty pleasing. Go to 20 kilohertz now, which is there. And again, there's just a little bit of time shift or phase shift from the input to the output, but you see that? Let me widen this out. But that's not really the wave shape. It's just the output is just slightly delayed behind the input. But that upper trace being the output, I don't see anything wrong with that compared to the input at all, do you? Now then, I'd like to go higher, but unfortunately, 20 kilohertz is as high as I can go with this online test tone generator that I'm using. And to get the accurate, I'm using my M-Audio audio interface as the output from the computer. It's designed for studio work, cheap studio work admittedly, but studio work nonetheless. So it's giving us a nice consistent output. And we noticed that on the scope, the input level to the amplifier wasn't changing at all. And over the frequency range, so that's pretty reasonable. It can also do different wave shapes, but I didn't feel the need to do that. But yeah, this is kind of cool. OnlineToneGenerator.com. It's quite handy actually for this sort of thing. So that's just a quick overview of this little guy. My next plan is to drop it onto a breadboard, make it more compact, and I think I'll just go with the 4.5 volt version single 9 volt rather than the 18 volt version, just to have as a handy dandy little utility amp. Yeah, so I'll just throw that together, I guess, and come back, because you've seen soldering and stuff before. I don't know whether it's important to show you that or not right now, but yeah, I'll just toss that together and I'll be right back.
Later that same evening.
Okay, let's try this guy out. Input off my little pink MP3 player. Turn him on to some random copyright-free music. And I'm going to use this little pair of speakers that I found. I remembered that I had upstairs. I've had that forever. It's basically a little set of bookshelf speakers for a Walkman or Panasonic equivalent. So I'll plug that in there and a battery. And that's with the volume control turned to minimum. Oh, wow. That's not bad. But my battery's actually pretty weak. You notice the LEDs pulsing with the music? But I think that's a success. And I could have made that more compact, I think, if I'd tried. But I'm not too stressed about it. If I put that into a case, there's kind of room for the battery to hang out over there somewhere. I'm not sure if I am going to put that in the case, though. I think I'm just going to use it as sort of a little utility high-gain amplifier just on my workbench here if I need to probe stuff or just listen to music or whatever. Yeah, I think that worked out pretty well, actually. Well, Hope you found that to be an interesting little circuit anyway. Oh, I bet you want to see what I did on the bottom of there, don't you? So, it's not super pretty. I tried to take my time and do a not bad job. But it wasn't intended to win any awards. But for you guys, I'll zoom in. So we got the power supply down in this corner. There's two voltage rails. Got the knob, the input and the output over there. I just ran a ground bus along here, and everything that's grounded is connected to that one bus wire. Unfortunately, I had to jump over a few things. If this was a higher frequency circuit, that would be a no-no, and I'd have to find a cleaner way to do it, but it's not bad. And because somebody's going to say it, yeah, I could have made a circuit board. I could have sent it to China. I could have paid $5 and gotten 5 boards and then paid $20 for shipping. But then I'd have 4 more boards than I need. And that would take weeks, and it would cost me, yeah, it's only $5 for the boards plus $20 shipping. This I did in an hour in an evening, and now I've got it. Yeah, I'm pretty happy with that. That was a fun evening's soldering and playing around. And thanks to Dustin for making me aware of this little circuit. And I guess to Mr. CMoy for coming up with it in the first place as a headphone amp. It's not that complex a circuit. You can see it there. I mean, this part up here is just the power supply. If I was powering it from something else, like I could create a dual power supply out of a couple of 18650s, or I could create a higher voltage power supply out of a couple of 9 volts, like I showed you earlier. But that's not bad. And basically, for each channel, there's what, a capacitor and 3 resistors. That's not even slightly complex. And you could substitute pretty much any op amp in there. This one happens to be a nice low noise, low distortion one, but for most headphone applications, it probably doesn't matter that much. Anyway, thanks for watching. Comments, questions down below as usual. I will talk to you later.